Hello everyone. In this video, we'll be talking about plant tissues. We know that all living organisms are made up of cells. So there are unicellular organisms as well as multicellular organisms. In unicellular organisms, single cell can perform several functions such as respiration, digestion, and excretion. For example, in amoeba, a single cell carries out movement, intake of food through pseudopodos, respiration and excretion. So as all the processes are formed by the single cell, so they do not require a complex structure. Whereas in multicellular organisms, there is division of labor. That means the work is divided among various types of cells to perform different type of functions. There are millions of cells which carry out different functions. The body of multicellular organisms exhibit organization at several levels. They follow a certain hierarchy. In large organisms, cell combine to make tissues, and collection of tissues makes an organ, and different organs in combination perform several functions and they form an organ system. For example, circulatory system, excretory system, digestive system, and so on. Then the last one, that is the highest level of organization, called organism, like human being. It can be a rat, it can be an elephant. So division of labor in multicellular organisms makes them highly efficient. For example, in human being, muscle cell contract and relax to cause movement. To perform different tasks like respiration, there is respiratory system. Nerve cells are responsible for carrying messages and signals from one part of the body to another. For digestion, there is another system we know, that is digestive system. So different organs like brain, lung, kidney, heart, liver, and so on, they are made up of different tissues to perform efficiently, to perform different tasks. Similarly, in plants, we have some cells responsible for movement and some for transportation of water and food. On the basis of these, they are divided. This means that a particular function is carried out by a cluster of cells at different place in the body, and this cluster or group is called tissue. A group of cells that are similar in structure or work together to achieve a particular function forms a tissue. There are certain differences between plant and animal tissue. Most of the plant tissues are dead and supportive in function. This is because of the lesser energy requirement by plants due to their fixed position, while most of the animal tissues are living as they have to perform different tasks like to move around in search of food, mates, and shelter. Another important difference is in the pattern of growth. Plants' growth is limited to certain regions, whereas growth in animals is uniform. And due to such differences in plants and animals, plant and animal tissues are categorized differently. Now, based on dividing capacity of the tissues, various plant tissues can be classified as growing or meristematic tissue and permanent tissue. There is no such demarcation in animals. Tissue in plants are organized as suited for stationary nature of plants, and in animals they are organized based on locomotion, that is mobility. Now let us talk about the tissues in more detail. Here we have various types of tissues in diagrammatic form. See, the tissues can be broadly divided into two types. One is animal tissue and another is plant tissue. So in this video, as you know, we'll be discussing about plant tissues. So in this slide, I have mentioned the further categorization of plant tissues. So plant tissue can be further categorized into meristematic and permanent tissue. So let's first talk about them in detail. Let us first talk about meristematic tissue. Active tissue that is found in the regions where plants actively grow. It's made up of bunches, small, densely packed, thin walled cells that keep on dividing to produce new cells. They have prominent nuclei and lack one major organelle, and that is vacuole. Why it is so? It's because vacuole's main function is to store water and provide support, and meristematic tissue needs neither. This is why vacuoles are very small or altogether absent. In Greek, meristem means divisible. So the name suggests this tissue is responsible for growth through division of cells, and the growth can be horizontal as well as vertical. It is present in roots and shoots and is responsible for unilateral growth. Unilateral growth means growth in one direction. As the cells of this tissue are very active, They have dense cytoplasm, thin cellulose walls. Depending on the region where they are present, meristematic tissue are classified as apical, lateral and intercalary. So, let's first talk about apical. As the name suggests, they are located at the apices of shoot, root and the opens. They are also known as growing points of the plant. The activity of the meristem brings about an increase in the length of organs. This results in the primary growth in the plants. Now let us talk about intercalary. They are present at the base of the leaf and at the internodes of twigs. They also contribute to primary growth of the plant. Then we have lateral meristems. Lateral meristems are accountable for increasing girth of the plant. That means the thickness. Its size increases. And this type of growth in plant is called secondary growth. Now, these are two permanent tissues which are protective in nature. One is epidermal and second is core. Epidermal cells cover the entire plant body during primary growth, whereas core cells cover the stem and root of the plant after the secondary growth of the plant. Now, I'll be discussing both epidermal cell and core cell together. So, we'll be discussing about them through a comparison. If I talk about epidermal cells, they occur during both primary and secondary growth of the plant, whereas core cells occur during secondary growth. Epidermal cells are found in leaves and other immature parts of the stem, and core cells are found in mature stem and roots. Epidermal cells are living in nature, whereas core cells are non-living in nature. Epidermal cells secrete cutin and core cells secrete suberin. Epidermal cell consists of single cell layer, whereas core cell consists of multiple layers of cells. And epidermal cells are found in all types of plants, whereas core cells are found in woody and many herbaceous dicots, gymnosperms and in some monocots. Now we have an important term to discuss, that is differentiation. So the process in which the meristematic tissue takes a permanent shape, size and function is known as differentiation. This implies the cell of meristematic nature differentiate to form different types of permanent tissue. Now, as you remember, there were two types of tissues. One was meristem and another was permanent tissue. So now, let's see how permanent tissues came into existence. The meristem, after attaining maturation, loses their ability to divide and take up specific role and form permanent tissue. Permanent tissues can be further classified into two types. Simple and complex. Simple tissues are made up of one type of cells forming a uniform homogeneous system of cells. They can be subdivided into parenchyma, colenchyma and sclerenchyma. Whereas complex tissues are made up of more than one type of cells that work together as a unit. And its examples are xylem and phloem. Let's discuss simple permanent tissues first. First one is parenchyma. They consist of live unspecialized cells having thin cell walls. They are loosely packed and have large intercellular space. They provide support to plants and present in all parts like root, stem, leaves, fruit and seeds. They help in storage of food and water. Sometimes these tissues also contain chlorophyll and perform photosynthesis, and at that time they are known as chlorenchyma. In case of aquatic plants, parenchyma is modified into aerenchyma. They help the aquatic plants to float. Now we have colenchyma. The cells of this tissue are living, elongated, that is long, and have irregular thickened corners. The term was coined by Schleiden. It provides flexibility and mechanical support to the plants. They have very little intercellular space. It allows easy bending of plants without breaking. That means they provide flexibility to the plant. I hope you have observed plants dancing in the wind. Then comes the sclerenchyma. The tissues are dead, which makes the plant hard and stiff. For example, husk of the coconut. Sclerenchyma are structurally very long and narrow. The walls of the cell are thick due to the presence of lignin. They lack intercellular space. These tissues are present in veins of the leaves, in nuts, in covering of the seeds, in stems, and around the vascular fundus. Okay, now let's have a look at complex permanent tissues. Remember, few seconds before we discussed that there are two types of complex permanent tissues. One is xylem and another is phloem. So let's know about them in detail. First one is xylem. So these are the dead and thick wall cells. Xylem is the water conducting element. That means it is responsible for transportation of water, which also provides mechanical strength to the plant. And now I think that as our common sense can tell us that, of course, if I give water to the plant, I'll be giving to the roots. And then this water will get transported to the leaves, to the stems. So of course, the movement will be upward. And there is no use of sending the water back to the roots. So can you notice that the movement will be unidirectional, that is in one direction only, that is from roots to other parts of the plant. Xylem can be further divided into four components: tracheids, vessels, xylem parenchyma and xylem fibers. So first is tracheids. So it is a tubular structure, means tube-like structure. Their cells are elongated with sharp ends. Can you see the shape? It helps in transportation of water and minerals vertically. Their main function is conduction of water. Then are vessels. This is also a tubular structure. The cells are elongated in this case also, and they are aligned end to end. They also help in transportation of water and minerals vertically. Their main function is also conduction of water. Now comes xylem parenchyma. It helps in storage of food. It conducts water in sideways. Then xylem fibers. They simply provide a support, and the cells are both elongated and pointed. Now comes phloem. Phloem is the food conducting element. That is, it helps in transportation of food. The material, that is food, it can move in both directions, because see, even the roots will require energy, so they will also need food. So the movement has to be bidirectional, it has to be in both the directions. Phloem is made up of four types of elements: sieve tube, companion cells, phloem fibers and phloem parenchyma. Except for phloem fibers, all phloem cells are living cells. Now first, sieve tubes. Sieve tubes are tubular cells with perforated walls. Perforated means the one which have holes. So this will help in movement of material. Then is companion cell. They are living cells. The cell wall is thin. The sieve tube and companion cell originated from the same mother cells. Then phloem fibers. They are the dead cells made up of sclerenchyma tissues. Its examples are jute, flax and hemp. Then is phloem parenchyma. They are living cells. They help in storage of food. They have nucleus and cellulosic cell wall, and it's absent in monocots. Okay, now there is one term, histology. I leave it up to you. Let's see whether you can guess what's histology or not. If you know the answer, please write it in the comment box. That's all for today. In the next video, we'll be talking about animal tissues. Till then, bye-bye. Hope you find this video informative and interesting. Please like and subscribe my channel. And yeah, before I end up the session, I would like to thank my viewers who showed interest in my videos. Yes, thanks everyone. Thanks for liking and encouraging me. Thank you.